Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name's Kim Dugan, if you don't know me. I have the distinct privilege and honor of introducing CSU Professor James W. Russell for his last talk at Eastern. not his last talk ever, I'm sure. I wrote a few things down about Jim. I've been working with Jim for 16 years or so, and I have more than a little bit to say about him, but I will be as brief as I can because I know you want to hear from him. Most of us here know Dr. Russell as a serious, productive, and tenacious scholar and instructor. He's a remarkable person who's done a lot of different things, written I don't even know how many books that you've written, a lot of books, and how many books? Eight books, numerous articles, countless, I should probably say. He's also, taught, I don't know how many students, thousands and thousands of students over the years, and we know him as an old school kind of professor and respect him for that. For his scholarship and what he brings to the classroom. I guess some of the things that I wanted to say personally, besides the fact that I really appreciate all the work that you did getting us retirement, though I have a bit of a way to go before I get there. When I get that check regularly, I will be thinking of you forever. So thank you for that. But when I think about you, Professor Russell, what I think about most is some of the stories that you've told over the years about your activism and some of the places that you were, like in Tulsa, desegregating schools, and some of your other work in the 1960s, which I've long admired. Maybe you won't be surprised to know that Professor Russell was brought back to Oklahoma to his high school. To be, awarded as a star from his high school, and he was not alone in this. He was next to Anita Bryant, who also went to his high school, and that was Anita Bryant. For those of you who don't know, was the anti-gay activist from the 70s who single-handedly tried to do a lot of things that we don't appreciate. Anyway, I could go on about Jim, but let me just tell you a couple of things that other people have said, and then I'll turn it over. So I want to read to you a quote. This is an excerpt from Hans H. Gerth, and I'm sure I'm going to mess up some pronunciations here, but he was formerly at the University of Wisconsin in 1973, and he said, quote, "Permit me to warmly recommend Jim Russell to you. He is a warm-hearted and forthright young man." This is 1973, and a good worker and promising scholar, no doubt. And as I say, what I say after 30 years of U.S. academic experience, he was in West Germany writing, I would rate him top rank among quite a few students of mine, among them C. Wright Mills, and two others that I'm going to mess up their names, Patrick Johns Hine and Dora Ashton Yunkers. Right. He continues, nothing detrimental about his private life has come to my knowledge. He's intelligent and discreet as to women, debts, and dope. If he ever tried, never. I'd feel sorry for him. another quote, and this one is from Francis Fox Piven, who was the president of the American Sociological Association, and she said this in recommending his book, Double Standard Social Policy in the United States, in 2006. Quote, this is a wonderful book, erudite and sophisticated, yet lucid and to the point. James W. Russell offers us a sweep portrait of the development of social policy in Europe and America and helps us to understand not only the differences between the European and American welfare state, but also why these differences are so important. Not all are intended with such high esteem as the quotes that I just read, but here's a quote. This was an argument between bloggers about the same book in 2009. Quote, by the way, your Marxist friend, James W. Russell, who authored the book you posted, the link to makes Obama look like Orrin Hatch from Utah, Russell is a tree-hugging, Birkenstock-wearing, just one more toque, make love, not war preaching, I can't make it in the real world, so I'll hang out in the liberal academia community type elitist hippie communist. I could vomit all over my keyboard. End quote. Finally, as some of you know, and I already mentioned this, Jim initiated and was a major part in securing retirement reform for many of us. Many of us have benefited, including himself, which is why he's able to retire at all. Among the letters of gratitude he has received is this, quote, I want to thank you for working tirelessly and generously for others. For my part, I have bought into the hybrid plan and have signed my retirement papers, choosing the option that will guarantee my wife a solid income. With best wishes and thanks, Sam Pickering. And for those of you who don't know, Sam Pickering is an emeritus professor of English at the University of Connecticut, and he was the basis for the character played by Robin Williams in the Dead Poets Society. Without further ado, James W. Russell.
Well, thank you, everyone, for coming. There may have been a few people who came to make sure that I really am leaving, but I am going to leave. I do promise that. And thank you, Kim, for those very nice remarks. When I was asked to do this, I had no idea what title I would have for this. And so the Vice President, Rona Free, said, oh, you don't have to have a title. So it went without a title, but then as I began to think about it more and more and more, the title came to my mind, which was Combining Scholarship with Activism. So Seymour Martin Lipset was a very prominent sociologist who died a few years ago. And I was reading an autobiography of him. It was an article where he talked about how he got into sociology, that he had been a political activist, and then he was able to go to Columbia University. And he said, I entered Columbia as an activist. I left as a scholar. That's something I would never say. Okay, that is to say that I have tried all of my career to really put the two of them together, because I do believe that the two of them do enhance each other. And so where does this come from? You know, I've tried to figure this out, as all of us do when we try to figure out our lives. And so I'll indulge in a bit of biography or autobiography with starting at the beginning. I was born in 1944, you can do the math, and that makes me a war baby, not a baby boomer, because baby boomers were born after the war. I was just short of being a baby boomer, okay? You know, it's kind of the end of 1944. And I was born in the state of New York, but I ended up growing up in Oklahoma. And so I, in terms of what makes me, I consider the Oklahoma part to be the stronger part of it. What I think is most important, though, is not the year that I was born in, but following from the Hungarian-German sociologist Karl Mannheim, who wrote a very influential article on generations, in which he says that to understand generations intellectually, you have to look at what was going on around them when they were coming of age, roughly between the ages of 18 and 23. Because up until you're about 18, you're pretty much a carbon copy of your family. But then after 18, you really have to figure things out for yourself. And then you figure things out for yourself in a particular context. So, I want to talk about that context. I think I was, in certain ways, very fortunate to come of age during the 1960s, a very exciting decade. I'm kind of at the beginning of the 68er generation. And so that's the time when I came of age. And I came of age in Oklahoma, which was a border, still is a border South state, had segregation in it. I've gone to segregated schools. I've ridden on segregated buses. I've gone to segregated restaurants. And so I come out of that particular historical period. So in and then Oklahoma is a very interesting place. It in 1912 had the highest vote ever of a state for a socialist candidate, Eugene Debs, for president of the United States. One third of the state voted for him. And today it is the most Republican of states. And so in a kind of odd twist of the word, it has gone from red to red, okay, you know, in this kind of way. But it is a state that has this very fascinating history to it. Well, in 1960, at the beginning of that decade, I was in high school, and it was the election between Richard Nixon and John F. Kennedy, and there was no question in my mind who was the better candidate, Richard Nixon, as I started very firmly. But I became very interested in politics. I'm not sure exactly why. Okay, but I was defining myself as a Republican as late as 1962 when there was a gubernatorial election in Oklahoma, which had had, it was a Southern Democrat state, and it was the beginning of the transition into the Republican state that it is now. And so I was in favor of Henry Bellman, I still remember these names, who was running for Republican of the state. Well, what I want to tell you is that following along with Mannheim's thesis of the importance of the coming of age, which is a period when people develop their own world view, which is the word that he uses for that, I went through more transformation between 1962 and 1964 in the development of my worldview than I've ever gone through ever since. Okay, and so those 2 years were particularly critical, because if I began in 1962 as being a Republican, by 1964 I was so far to the left that I was to the left of the Democratic Party, okay, that all kinds of things had happened. So what happened? In 62, I entered the University of Oklahoma, not as an activist, but as a curious student interested in politics. Then in the spring of 1963, my second semester there, I'm not sure how I came to find out about it, but there was an off-campus group that was discussing Karl Marx. And it was made up mostly of graduate students. There were a few undergraduates, including myself, a very curious freshman. And having grown up in Oklahoma and gone to high school, I think up till then I had considered sort of Marx the way I considered Hitler, as this kind of just totally something out there that had no relationship to anything that was decent. And so when I heard a lot of very smart people, okay, discussing very seriously Marx, it was a revelation to me. Now, I rarely use the word smart when I talk, because I don't like the way that intelligence has been used to keep people down. And so I don't think that people are born smart. I think smartness comes from the choices that people make in their life and the opportunities that they have. Well, this group was reading a book called The Marxists by C. Wright Mills. And so I got that book, and I'm not sure I understood a whole lot from it, but somehow I figured that the truth was somewhere within that book. And so that began a long intellectual journey with Mills. I still consider myself something of a Millsian. He exercised a kind of charismatic power over me. That is, I read that book, but I read everything that I could find by him. And so that was beginning to develop me in terms of a worldview and intellectually. Now, again, this is Oklahoma, and that then propelled me to look at models in Oklahoma. I learned about its socialist past, or at least part of it. It had had a number of legislators who were socialists. Oklahoma had three people in particular that were really admirable to me. One was in 1956, Oklahoma City had the first lunch counter sit-in in the United States, 4 years before the Greensboro sit-in, which is usually placed as the beginning of the civil rights movement. A woman named Claire Looper had led that. Then there was the Oklahoma of Woody Guthrie, the most prolific of American folk musicians, all of these wonderful songs that came out of him. Okay, and the whole period of the 1930s, the Dust Bowl, and all of the context of that. And then there was someone named Oscar Ammeringer, who was a German who came to the United States in the 1800s and made his way to Oklahoma, became a socialist organizer in Oklahoma, published a newspaper that came out of Oklahoma in the 1930s that had something like 200,000 subscribers in the United States. And he's often referred to as the socialist Mark Twain. I'll just give you one quotation from Oscar Ammeringer, who I really recommend that people look up. Let's see if I can remember it. Politics is the art whereby politicians obtain campaign contributions from the rich and votes from the poor on the pretext of protecting each from the other. Isn't that a great? I mean, I think that's still true today. That second semester of mine, person from Texas visited who was a traveler for a new student organization called Students for a Democratic Society. Okay. And he met with our group that was reading Marx. I began to correspond with their national office, began to get things from them. But at this time, I didn't quite know where to define myself politically. Someone had told me about the Americans for Democratic Action, which was an organization that included Eleanor Roosevelt, Arthur Schlesinger Jr., Chester Bowles, a number of people from the New Deal, the liberal part of the Democratic Party. And so that spring, with someone else who would actually go on to become the mayor of Tulsa, the two of us hitchhiked to Washington, D.C. From Oklahoma. In those days, people used to do a lot of hitchhiking. I don't recommend it today, okay, but we did a lot of it. Hitchhike when you didn't have money and you needed to get somewhere, that was the way to do it. So we did that, went to it. I was not particularly impressed by them as an organization. And so when I came back, I became much more dedicated to SDS. The summer of 63 in Tulsa, when I returned home, became involved with a project to survey restaurants that were still segregated. Part of the restaurants in the city had voluntarily desegregated, others were segregated. And so the NAACP was beginning a project to document the degree of segregation that was going to push toward a city ordinance. That fall of 63, I called up Clara Looper in Oklahoma City, asked her to come down and speak. Our now new SDS group sponsored her, and you know, when we went out to dinner with her, and as we were at dinner, I mentioned to her that the Cleveland County Courthouse, where Norman, Oklahoma is, still had segregated restrooms. Okay? And she just turned and said, "Well, what are you going to do about it?" So after that talk by her, the other person who you know, was active with me in forming the SDS chapter, we went down to the courthouse. I was the lookout. He had a can of turpentine, and so removed the designations. 2 days later, they put him back up, and then that led to a public hearing on the whole subject, and lots of people turned out to it, and the segregated designations were removed as a result of it. So that was a very successful initial project, to which someone remarked afterwards, "You know, you really should set your sights a little higher than restrooms, you know, if you want to change the world." Okay, but that we begin where we begin. In the spring of 64, went to hitchhiked again to an SDS conference in Hazard, Kentucky, of unemployed coal miners. And then on the way back, I heard word that sit-ins had started in Tulsa. So I beat my way back to Tulsa and took part in the sit-ins. I was arrested several times. And then in the summer of 64, at that point, we had moved from Tulsa to Sand Springs, which is a suburb of Tulsa. I noticed that the schools there were firmly segregated. And so I talked, by this time, a different, more militant civil rights organization, the Congress of Racial Equality, or CORE, had come to Tulsa. And so I talked with other people in CORE, and they put me in charge of a project of trying to figure out how to desegregate the schools. Well, a lot of really interesting stories about that, but one of the most fascinating is that the most famous resident of Sand Springs was a man named Marcus Haynes. Anybody who knows basketball knows him as the star of the Harlem Globetrotters. And he was from Sand Springs, went out, found him. He agreed to work with us. He became the spokesman for the group. And we were successful in desegregating Sand Springs schools. So I had a lot of activism, okay, during that period of time. And it was in civil rights. In the fall of 64, I sort of wanted to move on from Oklahoma. Okay, and so I went to the University of Wisconsin. And at the University of Wisconsin, you know, as I was looking through the faculty, I recognized the name Hans Girth, because he had been the teacher of C. Wright Mills. And so I immediately signed up for his class. And I got into it, and I was totally overwhelmed. Okay? I thought I was totally unprepared for this. I mean, here was a classical German scholar, okay, who had all of this knowledge. Here I was up from Oklahoma. Okay, you know, I had a certain amount of knowledge with me, but I really, thought it was. Yeah, I just couldn't do it. So after a few classes, I mean, I took notes as best I could. I didn't know who all these names were and all that he was just rolling off. And so I approached him and I said, you know, I think I'm going to have to withdraw from the class because I'm just not prepared for it. And he talked to me a little bit and he said, nah, just work at it. And so I did. And that began a 7-year relationship with him, where when I finished undergraduate, I became a graduate student, and I became very close to him, and tried to learn everything I could from him. And he just had an enormous amount of things to teach. So now he had been in Germany in the 1930s, had gone into exile, had been very close to Karl Mannheim at Frankfurt. There's, for those people who know the Frankfurt School, there, which is famous in terms of trying to put together a kind of synthesis of Marx and Freud and other major thinkers. Sometimes there's a confusion between the Frankfurt School and the sociology of knowledge circle, which the Frankfurt School included Adorno, included other people like that, and the sociology of knowledge circle included Mannheim, okay, and his followers. And they were very close. I mean, we're talking about people on the same floor in the same building. But in terms of intellectual history, that's what Goethe had come out of. And then when he had come to the United States, he had brought with him Max Weber. And so he became the first major, well, actually the second major translator of Weber. Talcott Parsons had translated the Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism. And then Goethe, with C. Wright Mills, with Goethe doing all the translating, brought out From Max Weber, which was a collection of Weber's essays that was the most widely read work on Weber. So the whole Goethe period is very important in my own intellectual development. The spring of 1965, I returned to Oklahoma because I figured out that I could save some tuition money if I would spend one semester at Oklahoma and then return to Wisconsin for my senior year. And so I threw myself back into activism in Oklahoma. And at this time, in 1965, the war in Vietnam is really escalating. Okay, and this is really the transition between the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement. And so we sponsored the first demonstration in Oklahoma against the war, which was in Oklahoma City. It was a picket line at a post office, got a lot of media attention. But what was very interesting was that day, Clara Luper had a civil rights demonstration. And so as we were picketing, her demonstrators came and joined it. And then we finished that demonstration and then moved over to the civil rights demonstration. So it's a good example of the blending of the civil rights and the anti-war movement. And that spring, the eight of us traveled from Oklahoma to Washington by a VW van, the old classic 1960s one, you know, a long drive, two nights, just straight through for the first march on Washington, which was April 17th, 1965, which was sponsored by SDS. And actually, 10 days ago was the 50th anniversary of that first march, which drew about 25,000 people to it. That summer, 1965, I decided I didn't want to stay in college, at least for a year. I want to take a year out. So I joined the National Office of SDS in Chicago. And boy, what a year that was. Okay, in the fall of 65, there was a second march on Washington, and this one drew 100,000 people. I mean, it was, you know, over a 5 or 6 month period. I mean, the whole anti-war movement was just mushrooming. And a lot of the national and international media thought that our office was the epicenter of all of this. So we had Japanese film crews in there. We, you know, you would stumble into the office in the morning and pick up the phone, and you were on the radio in Iowa wanting, you know, some statement about what was going on. By that spring, I became the founding editor of the newspaper of SDS, New Left Notes. And then, you know, at the end of that year, I returned to Wisconsin, okay, to finish as an undergraduate. Now, Wisconsin is an important place for me also, because Wisconsin, in spite of Scott Walker, okay, you know, being this very now conservative kind of showcase, Wisconsin has this tradition of progressivism that goes back to the La Follettes, and it was a state, you know, which really had these two different things. It's the state of fighting Bob La Follette and the state of Joe McCarthy. You know, so it always had these two very diametrically opposed sides to it. And University of Wisconsin in the 1960s was probably the most active campus in the country. The National Guard was called in three different times to occupy the campus. Anti-war demonstrations were very, very intense. I decided to stay in Wisconsin for graduate school. Did a master's thesis at looking at the servicemen from Wisconsin who had been killed in Vietnam as to what their income and class backgrounds were. I think everybody knew that the war was a raw deal for the poor, but nobody had really documented it. Okay, and so that, I still believe to this day, is the only documentation that exists of that, where I was able to demonstrate that soldiers who came from a poor background, okay, were much more likely to end up in Vietnam and end up being in danger of losing their lives, and in fact, losing their lives. And then for my dissertation, okay, I decided to take up the subject of Weber from Goethe, okay, and also the relationship between Weber and Karl Marx, because that was a debate at that time. Was Weber the anti-Marx? Was Weber the person who rounded out Marx, which is what Goethe and Mills argued? So I spent a lot of time reading very deeply. And it's that reading that has really formed me for the rest of my life, okay, in terms of my understanding of social theory. And it's also molded the types of projects that I've taken up over the years and what I thought was important. As I finished classwork at Wisconsin, I knew that I didn't want a job just anywhere. And so I managed to finagle my way into a job in San Francisco, which was a city that I had visited, that I had had a kind of first love for. And so I got the job. And that was good news. The bad news was it was a part-time job. And it was really the beginning of that. Okay, I think if I had been like 4 years older, okay, I would have come out of graduate school with my pick of jobs all over the country. Okay, but then that door slammed. Okay, at the end of the 1960s, there was really an excess of people who had credentials like I did. And then universities began to take advantage of it by having people teach part-time at poverty wages. Now, I can tell you, of course, I immediately got active on that issue in California. And I can tell you at that time, we were getting 80% of what full-timers were getting, and we really complained of that. Here at Eastern, part-timers get 44%. So it has only gotten much, much worse, okay, this whole insidious system of relying upon cheap teaching labor in the universities. But anyway, back to, so San Francisco was an important period. There, I was really fortunate to be around James O'Connor, who was an economist, who wrote a very instrumental book called The Fiscal Crisis of the State. He started a journal called Capitalist State, which I worked on in the early part of it, put us in touch with people in Germany, okay, who were also working on similar themes of, you know, around the whole analysis of the state. And O'Connor was just very, very creative. He was Marxist, but not dogmatic about it, but in that really kind of creative way. I spent 6.5 years at San Francisco State. Then, through a student, I was able to get a job at a place called the University of Texas at El Paso. Okay, and so off I went to El Paso. They hired me to teach sociology courses in Spanish. Okay, and by this time, I had been learning Spanish in San Francisco, and so they asked me if I could do it, and I said, sure, I can do it. I couldn't do it, right? Okay, but I needed the job, went to El Paso, took with me my Madison, my SDS, my San Francisco politics, and promptly got fired after 3.5 years, okay, in El Paso. But it was in El Paso that I met a labor organizer in the Southwest named Angela Morales, who would become my wife. So it was not an all bad experience. Okay. But it was also a very fascinating experience of being right on the border between the U.S. and Mexico. You know, lived about a half mile from the border. My wife and I did a lot of work on both sides of the border. That was when the Central American wars were heating up, and we did demonstrations against the war, which of course led to me getting fired at this university. And after I got fired, I remembered the comment by Paul Goodman, who some of you may know was a writer who has read a lot in the 1960s, who said that if you're a teacher and you haven't been fired, you're not doing your job. Okay. So I sort of took a certain amount of consolation at that. But there I was, unemployed. And there I was, close to career extinction. And I was told in El Paso that they would make it so that I could not get a job anywhere else in the United States. And indeed, they attempted to stop me from getting the job at Eastern. Okay, they made phone calls and so forth. And I'm really happy that they didn't succeed. Okay, so I have been, I became a kind of academic survivor. Okay, let me kind of move forward. So I went into unemployment, went to Portland, Oregon for a temporary job. Then I came to Eastern in 1986. But I've been here ever since, except for 2 years on a Fulbright at the National University of Mexico in Mexico City. While I've been here, first is when I came here, I came with the attitude that, okay, I better cool it on the activism and just concentrate on scholarship and, you know, to survive. And that lasted for about 3 months because then I met Sandy Taylor, okay, of Curbstone Press, and we started working together and, you know, just continued on with the Central America work. I mean, I would say that, you know, Eastern, one of its several major missed opportunities was that it could have had Curbstone Press as Eastern's press for very little money. And Curbstone Press really put this whole area on the map internationally. They became the publishers of a lot of really internationally renowned people. All kinds of people came through here. I can remember once being on a street corner in Managua, Nicaragua, during the war, and being introduced with somebody with me who was from Washington, D.C., that the two of us were from Washington and Willimantic, as if these were cities of equal status in the world economy. And in a certain way, they were in Central America, because they did a lot of publishing of major Central American figures. And so at Eastern, I've managed to get a fair amount of work done in terms of books and interests and so forth. I moved from being primarily interested in class and race in the US, Mexico, and Canada in the context of NAFTA in the early 90s, from the period that I was in Mexico City to beginning in 2000 or so, becoming more interested in social policy, shifting to that, and then to what is really the culminating project was tackling the whole state retirement system. Now, if you had asked me in 1968 or had said, do you think you'll be dealing with retirement, I would have thought you were completely nuts. I mean, that sounded like the most boring subject in the world. Of course, none of us were ever going to get old anyway, right? Even if we did, we wouldn't do that. But I found this situation in which when I ran the numbers between two different retirement systems, the difference was so dramatic, okay, that I couldn't believe it. Okay, and then I would start telling people, and their eyes would kind of glaze over, and they would, kind of look at their watch and, try to get away from me. Okay, and all of that changed in 2008 when, this is a joke that I never tire of telling, so many of you have heard it, that in 2008, when the stock market did its biggest plunge, okay, in October of 2008, okay, the day after it did its plunge, the campus representative of our retirement plan, ING, sent around a message to everyone saying he would be available for counseling on our investments. Okay, and I was feeling really snide. And so I shot back a reply to all and said, would that include psychological counseling, given that, a quarter to a third of our whole retirement security has gone up in smoke, in this Wall Street meltdown that's before our eyes? And that set off a series of jokes, okay? But then a faculty member named Marcia McGowan, okay, who, someone I didn't know particularly well, approached me and said, isn't there something we can do? And I said, I don't think so. Nobody wants to hear it. She said, but yes, they're scared now. And so we wrote a letter of concern, okay, that flew all over the state, started an organization, took on the whole state retirement system, ING, which is the company that ran it, and I'm sorry to say, very powerful forces in our own union, the AAUP, okay, who tried to kill this reform at an early point. And one of the things that I learned was that I, of course, had figured all of this out. Okay, I knew the theory, I had read all the books about retirement systems, but that wasn't going to cause any change. Okay, just walking into somebody's office and say, here, look at this, this is it. And I had tried that, and nothing changed. But what I knew from back in the 60s is that if you want change, you have to organize. Okay? Nothing's going to happen until you're organized. And so we put together an organization. Okay, that included a website, included a newsletter, included a 15-person steering committee. Okay, there were some people at Eastern who were really instrumental in that. Jim LaMonaco is very key. Without Jim LaMonaco, this thing would have been killed behind closed doors. And he was in those meetings to stop that from happening. Okay, Bill Newell was important. Ann Dawson was important in helping, and of course, Marsha McGowan. And so that was a struggle that was won. And when I think of all the things that I've been involved in, that is probably the most important single thing I've ever been involved in terms of the amount of money that was involved. As of now, something like $224 million has rolled from the private sector into the state sector. 1,800 people have transferred, 250 people have retired. If you look at all of these retirement ceremonies around here, the only people who are retiring are the people who are in the state pension. Okay, the people who are in the plan that we left from, they're going to work until they die, I think. I mean, because it's a plan that is not meant for retirement security. Okay, I mean, that's just it. I mean, it's a savings account, and you can save all your life, and you still won't have enough to retire on it. So let me just kind of sum up here. Okay, a few kind of parting words, which are critical words. What I would do if I was going to be here another 10 years, okay, projects I would work on. The first is that it seems to me in Connecticut that we have a very critical problem in unequal state support for our higher education institutions, that the University of Connecticut monopolizes the support in the state. It monopolizes public attention, and it has created a two-tier system. And that is something that should be fought. There's no reason why we should have, quote, the flagship out there and then everybody else is second. We need to have a system in which Connecticut residents can choose between equally high-quality systems that are equally supported by the state legislature. And for those people at Eastern, especially the faculty, they should not accept the second-place status, but should challenge it. That our claim should be that we are scholars who also care about teaching. Okay? We're not identical to UConn, but we're as good as UConn. Okay, we just do it in a different kind of way, and it requires support. One of the real problems from the point of view of teachers, I think research has to be a part of the mission here, but there is no support for it, or precious little support. And the key piece of support is the teaching load. At UConn, they have all kinds of support because they have half the teaching load of faculty here. Eastern missed a huge opportunity. Okay, when several years ago, we showed them how they could reduce the teaching load without it costing anything. Anya Kirschman worked on that, Jeff Trawick-Smith and I. We were close to winning it, and then it was abandoned by people who had the power to have allowed it to go through. That should come back. People should fight for the four-credit courses. Then, of course, the major issue that we're dealing with right now is this attempt at corporate reform of CSU and the community colleges. And I'm really happy to say that faculty, you know, have come together, have fought that. There is a no-confidence vote tomorrow in the president of the system. But everybody has to pay attention, because you can get rid of the president, but then they just bring in somebody who's more skillful at ramming down our throats a corporate reform of this place that'll end education as we know it. Then my final piece of reform, and this is addressed to the faculty, we need a stronger union. The AAUP has been weak. Okay? It has a goal of shared governance, which is a managerial goal, not a union goal. It needs to be on these issues. Some of the most important, harshest fight that I had to do for the retirement reform, which was the biggest single financial benefit that faculty have received in years, was in opposition to the AAUP or various people within the AAUP. They never really got it. Okay, and even though I ended up having to counsel all of their leaders in their own individual situations, and they transferred, but they never were able to embrace it as a union issue. And then deep within that is the issue of the part-time faculty here. Over half the faculty are part-time, receive much less in income, 44%. They're over a majority of the union members, but they're not represented in any of the union leadership bodies. There may be a violation of state labor law in this. The union has to put the part-time issue in first place in the 2016 election if it's really going to represent that substantial part of its members. Okay, that's it. Thank you.